Hello and welcome to the NCBE's first video in our Home Science Resources series. Today you will be transformed into sensory scientists with the ability to go through your own sensory science test at home. But before we crack on, we're going to give you the opportunity to learn a little bit about sensory science, the five basic tastes, and then it's your time to go ahead and run your very own sensory science test. What is sensory science? Well, sensory science is a food scientist's way to measure and interpret people's reactions to food using the five senses, so sight, smell, taste, touch, and also hearing. And from these reactions, we're able to determine what types of food people like and also the quantities of food that people will eat. And from this, we're able to work out what foods people like and dislike and why. And this helps us if we work for certain food companies, because we're able to see what of our products people like and what things we can improve before our products hit the shelves, which makes sure that our products will be bought and also enjoyed by the consumers. As well as the five senses, which play a really important part in sensory science, we've also got the five basic tastes. These not only help us to describe food, but they're also really important survival mechanisms in some instances. So, I'd like you to pause the video, and if you're doing this with people, have a discussion about the five basic tastes and what you think they might be. If you're doing them on your own, just have a think about it. Think about what could be the five words that we'd use to describe lots of different foods, and also have a think about what certain food products you could use to describe those tastes really well. So I'm sure you came up with most of these, but our five basic tastes are sweet, salty, sour, bitter, and umami. Now, in the picture, you can see some of the foods that I came up with that can really help us to describe those tastes. There are lots of other ones which you might have come up with. We're going to go through each of these tastes individually and you can find out a little bit more about them. But before we do that, we're just going to have a talk about taste and how both your nose and your mouth interplays with sensory science. Now, if you stick out your tongue, so you can do this now or the next time you're in front of a mirror, you'll see little bumps on your tongue. Everyone's got different amounts of these bumps, and also some people have them in different places. Now, those bumps contain your taste buds, and within your taste buds, you've got what we call taste receptors, where these different molecules, whether that's salt molecules or sugar molecules, will travel to those receptors, they will join to them, and that is how you then get a taste for a certain modality. So whether that's sweet, or whether that's salty, whether that's bitter, for example. Your nose also plays a really key role in sensory science. Now, when you open up a packet of crisps, a packet of flavoured crisps, or you open up a jar of coffee, you release lots of odour molecules, so lots of gas molecules that can travel to your nose, and they will then stimulate receptors within your nose, allowing you to get an aroma and also a flavour. So a further video that we're going to do in the coming weeks will explain to you the difference between taste, flavour and aroma. So watch out for that one when it comes out. So now to go through each of the tastes separately. So first of all, we're going to start with sweet. So sweet is a lot of people's favourite tastes. And sweet comes in lots of different foods, whether that's biscuits, chocolate, fruit, lots of other ones that you've probably come up with. And it's our taste receptors responding to sugar. Whether that's sucrose, so like the sugar I showed you in the photo that you'd use to bake a cake with, whether that's fructose in fruit, or glucose, or any other types of sugar, they all will give you different types of sweetness and slightly different flavours as well. So there's sugar found in lots of different products, and that's what your taste receptors are responding to. We're then going to move on to salty. So salty is our body's way of responding to sodium chloride, or NaCl. Also other salts such as potassium chloride, KCl. Salt doesn't only make things tasty, so we often add salt when we're cooking to give it extra flavour, but it's also got lots of other roles. Salt can be used to extend the shelf life of things, and it was used as a really common preservation method for things like fish. That's because when you add lots of salt to something, the bacteria that normally grows to make your food go off finds it really difficult to grow when something is really salty. Salt can also be used for lots of other functions. It makes meat more tender, and it also can be used for baking bread, and it helps with the crust formation. More on that later on when we produced a video about bread making. So we're now going to move on to sour, such as the lemon that I showed you. We've also got things like Haribo Tang Fast Sticks, lemons, limes, other citrus fruits like oranges, sour fruits like blackberry. We've all tasted something sour. And this is your taste receptors responding to acidity, or what we call hydrogen ions. So the more acidic something is, the lower its pH. So something that's really acidic, we generally say has got a pH of less than 4, and this has a really high concentration of hydrogen ions. This acidity can either be naturally present in foods, for example in a lemon, or it can be added to foods, for example like sour sweets or drinks that are sparkling drinks that have that sour note in them. We then move on to bitter. Now, bitter is quite a difficult one to describe, and some of you may not really know what bitter is. Well, bitter is associated with foods like dark chocolate, coffee, and dark green vegetables such as Brussels sprouts, which some of you might turn your nose up and say, I really don't like them. Some of us are a lot more sensitive to bitter. I'm personally very sensitive to bitter. I don't like things like coffee. But some of us love things like double espresso and really dark bitter chocolate, and we like bitter flavours. And bitter can often develop over time, so you'll find that adults are more able to like things that are bitter. Something like tonic water, that's one of the really bitter foods, and that contains a compound called quinine, which is what makes it really bitter. And now moving on to umami. So you've probably not heard of that one before. Umami can be described as savoury or delicious taste, and that's quite a new taste, and it's what sensory scientists would determine as the fifth taste. I gave you some vegetable stock, but other things that are really umami would be soy sauce, mushrooms, Parmesan cheese, and for example, beef stock. Now, all of those products naturally contain glutamic acid and a sodium salt, making the compound monosodium glutamate, which I'm sure a lot of you have heard of. Now, monosodium glutamate provides a really savoury flavour, and that's naturally present in a lot of those foods that I just mentioned. Why is sensory science important in the food industry? You do know that some people's jobs is tasting chocolate, tasting crisps, working for companies like Cadbury and Walkers. That's their actual job. Sounds really fun, right? I mean, I'd love it. But why do companies employ people to do that? Well, actually, tasting and the tasters are really important to the companies because they want to check that you and I, so people that go to the supermarkets to buy the products, like them and will continue to buy them, because you're not going to continue to buy something if you don't like it. And they need people to give them real and honest feedback on their products. At the moment, companies are really having to reduce things like salt, sugar, and fat in their products to match up to government guidelines. And that means they have to change the ingredients, which often alters the flavour and the texture. They need people to go in and taste the products once they've changed the ingredients and see what they think. And they can continue to alter the recipe until they get the okay from the tasters before it can then be brought out onto the shelves. And they'll often get us to see whether we can tell the difference between, for example, a sugar reduced and a non-sugar reduced variety of a certain food product. Another reason why companies do this is packaging. At the moment, there's a real push for sustainable packaging, packaging that can be recycled, for example, cardboard or non-plastic packaging. That means that the type of material the packaging is in will have to change, and also the design on the packaging will also have to change. And they want to make sure that if this packaging changes, we will still buy the product and we'll still pick it up off the shelves so that the company will still be making money. Time for you all to be transformed into sensory scientists, the moment you've all been waiting for in the video. So today we're going to be doing a certain type of sensory science test, which is called a discrimination test, also called a difference test. It's not the only sensory science test that you can do, but today this is what we're going to be focusing on. And if you tune into some further videos, you can have a go at some other sensory science tests. The next ones are called attribute profiling, which means you are going to be describing food depending on what you can taste, what flavours you have, what aroma you're getting, and you're going to be dividing up the product into the different attributes, for example, creamy or salty. But today we're going to be doing the discrimination test and seeing whether or not you can tell the difference between two very similar food products. So time for the triangle test, which is one of the simplest and the most used discrimination tests used within sensory science. I'm going to demonstrate to you now how you can do this, and then you can go away and do this test with your siblings, with your family members, with your friends, whoever you're doing this video with, or whoever's in the house. But don't worry, if you're doing this on your own and there's no one to do your test with you, that's okay. You can do one yourself and you're still going to be testing out how good your taste buds are. So for this test, you are going to need two different products. Two very similar products that are slightly different. So for this test for me, I have got 3/4 of toast, one of which has Nutella on it, and two of which have Sainsbury's hazelnut chocolate spread. You could use anything that is the same type of product, but slightly different. For example, you could be using apple juice, so a premium brand apple juice and a supermarket owned brand. The same goes with orange squash or blackcurrant squash. You could be using a Ribena and then a supermarket owned brand. You could be using full fat milk and comparing it to skimmed milk or semi-skimmed milk. Extra creamy yogurt, comparing it to more standard yogurts. You could be using different types of tea, different brands of coffee. You could also be looking at, for example, different types of ketchup. So a branded ketchup and an own brand ketchup, a reduced salt and sugar ketchup compared to a normal ketchup. You could be looking at reduced sugar chocolates, reduced sugar biscuits, or a branded biscuit compared to a supermarket own biscuit. There's lots of different possibilities here. And I've got some more examples in the PDF file that you will find with the YouTube video. So have a root around in your cupboards and see what you can find, and I'm sure you'll all be able to find something that you can do the test with. So back to my plate. I've got my three samples on here, and as you can see, you don't have very big samples. You could even cut these up smaller and give people an eighth of a piece of toast, depending on how much bread you've got in the house, if you need to use bread. Could be half a square of chocolate, a little slice of apple if you wanted to compare different varieties of apple. And make sure you arrange them on your plate like this, and you can give them little number codes. So as you can see, I've got three different number codes here that are random numbers, and it allows you to make sure the test is not as biased and that people are just going to be looking at the taste rather than comparing any other thing, for example, the appearance of the product or trying to guess which one they think it is. It's important, if you can, to try and find a white plate or a white piece of kitchen roll or a white piece of paper to display the products on, because it just is how we would normally do it in sensory sciences, making sure someone has a white background, again, to try and eliminate any form of bias. Also give people a drink of water so that in between each sample they can have a drink of water to cleanse their palate slightly before they go on and taste the next sample. So the aim of this is you're going to be having your three samples, and you need to work out which one is different. You've got two samples that are identical and one that is slightly different, and to see how good your taste buds are and how many of you can tell which one is different. Before we go, I've got one quick question for you before you all dash off and find out what you've got in your cupboards or in your fridge. This triangle test, we've got three samples, as I said, and one of them is different. So can you all tell me what is the probability of someone guessing the right answer? So they're not sure which one is different and they're just going to say one of the samples, what is the probability that that person is going to get it right? Pause the video, think of the answer, and then come back to me. So you've probably got the right answer. The right answer is 1/3. So if you're not sure of the answer and you're going to guess it, you've got 1/3 of a chance of getting it right, because one of these samples out of the three is the different sample. So there's 1/3 of a chance of you guessing correctly, even though you didn't actually know the answer. But try and use your taste buds and work out which one is different. Okay, so I'm now going to give you some time to pause the video, go ahead and do your sensory science test. So remember, you're looking for two different types of products that are very similar, but they have slight differences, whether that's brand, whether that's shop they're bought from, whether that's the nutritionals or the ingredients. So go ahead and find something. Remember to wash your hands before you do this, and wash your hands before you're going to be preparing any of the food for people. And try your best to find something white to put the products on, whether that's a little white plate, a piece of kitchen roll, or a piece of white A4 paper. And remember to number the samples and make sure you've got written down somewhere which sample is the odd one out so that you can tell people when they get the right answer. So go ahead, do that, pause the video and come back, and we'll be really interested to see how many of you could tell the difference. So could you tell the difference? How many of you got the right answer? How many people in your family got the right answer? So if you did, that's amazing. You've got really good taste buds. You were really able to tell the difference and you were able to distinguish between the two products. Or was it that they were quite different? Have a look and see what you thought. If you weren't able to tell the difference, maybe that's just because the company has done a really good job. Because sometimes companies will compare their product to, for example, a supermarket own brand, another leading brand. If they're a supermarket own brand, they might compare it to the leading brand of the product to see how well they compare. So maybe they've just done really well in trying to match the sensory characteristics between the two products. I hope you've enjoyed today. I hope you've enjoyed being sensory scientists and taking part in your sensory tests. And maybe when you have your lunch or your dinner, you'll be able to think back as to what you're tasting. So please tune in for the next video, which is going to be looking at apples and potatoes. Your apples and potatoes go brown when they're left outside. So tune in next week to find out about that.